one good U.S. critic, Harold Rosenberg, once described intellectuals as the herd of independent minds. They think they're very independent, but they're stampede in a herd, which is true. When there's a party line, you have to adhere to it. And the party line is systematic. The party line is subordination to state power and to state violence. Now, you're allowed to criticize it, but on very narrow grounds. You can criticize it because it's not working, or it's a mistake, or benign intentions that went astray, or something. Like you see it right now in the Iraq War. There's a ton of debate about the Iraq War, but take a look at it. It's very similar to the debate in Pravda during the invasion of Afghanistan. Actually, I brought this up to a Polish reporter recently and asked him if he'd been reading Pravda. He just laughed. So yeah, it's the same. Now, you read Pravda in the 1980s, it's you know, the travail of the Russian soldiers, too many are getting killed, there are these terrorists who prevent us from bringing justice and peace to the Afghans. We of course didn't invade, we intervened in order to try to help them at the request of the legitimate government, and the terrorists are preventing us from doing all the things we want to do, you know. Yeah, I've read Japanese counterinsurgency documents from the Second World War, from the 1930s in China. Same, you know, we're trying to bring them an earthly paradise, but the Chinese bandits are preventing it. In fact, I don't know of an exception in history. You go back to British imperialism, it's the same. I mean, even people of the highest moral integrity, like John Stuart Mill, were talking about, well, we have to intervene in India and conquer India because the barbarians can't control themselves, they're commit atrocities, with to bring them the benefits of British rule and civilization and so on. Now, in the United States, the same. Now, take the bombing of Kosovo. That was a critically important event for American intellectuals. And the reason had to do with what was going on during the 90s. The 90s are, for the West, not just the US, I mean, France and England are worse. It's probably the low point in intellectual history for the West, I think. I mean, it was like a comic strip mimicking a satire of Stalinism, literally. You take a look at the New York Times and the French press, the British press, it was all full of talk about how there's a normative revolution that has swept to the West. For the first time in history, a state, namely the United States, the leader of the free world, is acting from pure altruism. Clinton's policy has entered into a noble phase with a saintly glow. On and on. I'm quoting from the liberals.
Now, this particular humanitarian charade
was pre-Kosovo,
right? And it was specific in a sense because it was based on the claim that it was preventing genocide. Let me just read something that you said in an interview around the time of the bombing. You said, the term genocide, as applied to Kosovo, is an insult to the victims of Hitler. In fact, it's revisionist to an extreme. What did you mean by that?
First of all, let me just fix the timing. Right. The things I've been quoting are from the late 90s.
Before Kosovo.
Now, they needed some event to justify this massive self-adulation. Okay, along came Kosovo, fortunately. All right, so now we have to stop genocide. What was the genocide in Kosovo? We know from the Western documentation what it was. In the year prior to the bombing, according to just the Western sources, about 2,000 people were killed. Killings were distributed. A lot of them were coming, in fact, according to the British government, which was the most hawkish element of the alliance, up until January 1999, the majority of the killings were by the KLA guerrillas, who were coming in, as they said, you know, to try to incite a harsh Serbian response, which they got, in order to appeal to Western humanitarians to bomb. Well, we know from the Western records that nothing changed between January and March. In fact, up until March 20th, they indicate nothing. March 20th, they indicate an increase in KLA attacks. But it was ugly, you know, but by international standards, I mean, almost invisible, unfortunately. And it was very distributed. If the British are correct, the majority was coming from KLA guerrillas.
And as it later turned out, the KLA was also receiving financial and military support. I mean,
they were being supported by the CIA nearly in those months. Okay, so that's not to call that genocide. Is really to insult the victims of the Holocaust. The Western intellectuals were praising themselves for their magnificent humanitarianism, and much worse atrocities were going on right across the border in Turkey. That's inside NATO, not at the borders of NATO. They were saying, how can we allow this at the borders of NATO? Yeah. How about inside NATO, where Turkey was carrying, had driven probably several million Kurds out of their homes, destroyed about 3,500 villages, laid waste to the whole place, every conceivable form of torture and massacre that you can imagine, killed nobody knows how many people, we don't count our victims, tens of thousands of people. How were they able to do it? The reason is because they were getting 80% of their arms from Clinton. And as the atrocities increased, the arms flow increased. In fact, in one single year, 1997, Clinton sent more arms to Turkey than the entire Cold War period combined, up until the counterinsurgency. That was not reported in the West. You do not report your own crimes. That's critical. And in the midst of all of this, how can we tolerate a couple of thousand people being killed in Kosovo, mixed guerrillas and, you know. In fact, the 50th anniversary of NATO took place right in the middle of this.
In the middle of the moment.
And there were lamentations about what's going on right across NATO's border. Not a word about the much worse things going on inside NATO's border, thanks to the massive flow of arms from the United States. And that's only one case. Comparable things were going on all over, with the U.S. and Britain supporting them. Much worse. But this, you had to focus on this. That was the topic for the Herd of Independent Minds. Played a crucial role in their self-image because they had been going through a period of praising themselves for their magnificence in their normative revolution and the noble phase and so on and so forth. So it was a godsend. And therefore you couldn't ask any questions about it. Incidentally, the same happened in the earlier phase of the Balkan Wars. So they're awful and so on and so forth. However, if you look at the coverage, for example, there was one famous incident which just completely reshaped Western opinion. That was the photograph of the thin man in the behind the barbed wire. Well, you remember the thin man behind the barbed wire. So that was Auschwitz, and we can't have Auschwitz again. So, you know, everyone, the intellectuals went crazy. French were posturing on television and the usual antics. Well, you know, it was investigated, and carefully investigated. In fact, it was investigated by the leading Western specialist on the topic, Philip Knightley. He's a highly respected media analyst, and his specialty is photojournalism. Is the most, probably the most famous Western and most respected Western analyst of this. He did a detailed analysis of it, and he determined that it was probably the reporters who were behind the barbed wire, and the place was ugly, but it was a refugee camp. People could leave if they wanted, right near the thin man, there was a fat man, and so on. Well, you know, there was one tiny newspaper in England, I mean, probably 3 feet, called LM, which ran a critique of this. The British, who haven't the slightest concept of freedom of speech, that is total fraud, a major corporation, ITN, big media corporation, had publicized these. So the corporation sued the tiny newspaper for libel. Well, British libel laws are absolutely atrocious. A person who's accused has to prove what he's reporting was done with malice. You can't prove that. So, and in fact, when you have a huge corporation with batteries of lawyers and so on, carrying out a suit against three people in an office who probably don't have pocket money, it's obvious what's going to happen, especially under these grotesque libel laws. So yes, they were able to prove, the little newspaper couldn't prove that it was done with malice, put out of business. There was just euphoria in the left liberal British press. Mm-hmm. After they put the newspaper out of business under this utterly grotesque legal case mm-hmm. in British laws, the left liberal newspapers, like The Guardian, and the, were just in a state of euphoria about this wonderful achievement. They had managed to destroy a tiny newspaper because it questioned some image that they had presented and they were very proud of themselves for, mm-hmm. which was probably misunderstood or misinterpreted. Well, Philip Knightley wrote a very harsh critique of the British media for behaving in this way and tried to teach them an elementary lesson about freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. He also added that probably the photograph was misinterpreted. Mm-hmm. Couldn't get published. Yeah. Well, you know, that's when Kosovo came along, it's the same thing. Mm-hmm. That you cannot tell the truth about it. In fact, I've gone through a ton of reporting on this. Mm-hmm. Almost invariably, they invert the chronology. There were atrocities. The
after
fact
the
is
bombing.
They were after the bombing. The way it's presented is the atrocities took place and then we had the bomb to prevent genocide. Just invert it.